Welcome to The Upshot, Ultra World Disc Golf's podcast about the latest in the disc golf world. I'm the editor, Charlie Eisenhood. Joining me is Josh Bansfield on this Tuesday, December 3rd. It's a great day. The Upshot Awards are being given out today. Nobody wants to hear about these DGPT awards. What is going on with those? They got all kinds of weirdness. Today, we give you the facts. The true awards, the ones you need. Josh, you got to be feeling good because the Broncos got a crazy win last night.
I'm feeling great. Man, I was really afraid that Jerry Jeudy's revenge game was not going to go our way. And you know what? He did well. Good for him. But, you know, we're in the playoffs and they're going to have an early round draft pick. So
if you had asked me before the season, what are the odds that the Broncos play better than the 49ers for the first half of this year, I would say 0%.
If I had put a prop bet for you that said Niners don't make the playoffs, Broncos do, and put like $50 on that.
Oh my God, dude.
I'd be cashing out for a lot of money right now.
All right, let's get into it. Before we talk awards, we got to talk about the news of that came out late last week.
I think it was like the day we recorded,
right,
too.
It was, yeah, because it was right before Thanksgiving.
Yeah.
I mean, this was like News Dump 101. Innova announces that Ken Climo is going to be leaving Team Innova. I mean, he is the gold star. I mean, this guy has plastics named after him. He's got discs named after him. I mean, he's the legend, you know, arguable GOAT, and leaving Innova. Crazy. And it says in the article from Innova that he is, you know, he got an offer that he could not pass up. And so immediately speculation beginning about what this all means. And Josh, what was your initial reaction to hearing that he was going to be leaving Innova?
Like, it's something that doesn't feel quite, like it's something that doesn't feel quite right, right? Like, if somebody had showed up to Thanksgiving with, like, I don't know, a plate of like fried rice instead of mashed potatoes, right? Like, I'd be like, huh? And not the rest of the dish. Like, if you want to do a Chinese Thanksgiving, I am all in favor of that. Like, that sounds great. But in place of the mashed potatoes, and you have everything else traditional, like, it's just like it doesn't fit. Like, you took out a staple of that team. But the other thing I think back to is like, how much money is Innova paying Climo that for discs that have his name on them that I don't think are moving because they have his name on them, right? I know you can buy Climo Wraiths or Climo Destroyers or I don't even know what other discs that I'm sure he still is getting some royalties from, but I just don't believe that people are going to go buy a Wraith because of Ken Climo anymore. So if you're Innova, you're probably spending a lot of money. Like, you're keeping Climo on because it's weird not to have Climo, but I don't really think he's generating sales for you these days. I don't think if Climo got an offer he can't refuse, he's obviously not making the money that he wants from Innova these days. But it's odd to me because I don't understand how another company plans on leveraging this to make a significant amount of money.
When I saw this, I was like, okay, like, let's go through the scenarios that would make sense.
Okay.
One is maybe he's going to become a full-time commentator and DGN is like changing their rules about,
sure,
like allegiances to disc companies and like having a sponsorship and also being an active commentator, which, you know, I have no idea what pro sports do on this front. Probably nothing. So, and obviously DGN has plenty of commentators who have specific sponsorship allegiances. Go ahead.
Sorry. There was an article about speculation that when Brady buys the Raiders, he might have to resign from his commentary position.
Well, that's kind of different than being like owning a team.
Sure.
Is different than like being sponsored by Gillette or whatever.
Sure, 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 sure.
Brady sponsors are anymore, but you know, it is a little more murky when you're sort of like have a financial relationship with a company that's very tightly tied to the sport.
Well, that's
which, you know, I think disc golf kind of has to just live with the fact that it's like awkward right now because people aren't making enough money for that to not work out. You know, if DGN could pay people $500,000 a year, they could say you don't get to have a sponsor.
Right. Right.
So that was my first thought. But I was like, that doesn't really make sense. Like that would be a weird, like they would just announce that he was going to DGN full time as a commentator. Right.
Right.
So then it's like, okay, well, then he must be going to another disc company. But then I'm going through in my head, I'm like, well, what makes sense? Like, why? Like, who is paying up for this, the premium to pay for him to come to their company? And I immediately came to the conclusion that it has to either be Discraft or MVP. And the reason would be more or less symbolic. Like, we are taking over as the preeminent disc company.
Mm-hmm.
And Innova is no longer it. And we're going to go in and we're going to take your best player. Since that time, since I've sort of been thinking about this, we have received information from multiple sources that say he will be going to Discraft on a multi-year deal at over $200,000 a year. And in many ways, it makes sense. If you think about the tea leaves that we've seen over the last few years, Macbeth talking about, I want to get Ken Climo more involved.
Mm-hmm.
And like he's been saying that in press conferences. And like Macbeth doesn't do anything randomly. Don't you think this to me has the fingerprints of Macbeth making this happen and they're going to make like goat discs or whatever with Macbeth Climo branding? And that's the concept. Now, I don't know if that's enough to like sell enough discs to make this make sense. But it is a power move from a company that has grown a lot in the last 5 years, picking up Macbeth, picking up Pierce. They've got, you know, AB. All indications are that they're working really hard to re-sign AB. And now they go out and they get Ken Climo. I think it's I'm not convinced it's going to work from like a dollars and cents perspective, but from a symbolism perspective and for what it communicates, it's a big time power move.
You're right. You're absolutely right. I still like symbolism doesn't pay the bills in a, especially in an economic downturn of our sport. So like it's weird to me. If this had happened 2 years ago, then I wouldn't even, I probably wouldn't even blink. Right. The industry is flush with money. Ken Climo's sitting there getting, you know, he started to do a couple commentary gigs. He's still getting some okay royalties from Innova, and Discraft says, you know what, we'll pay you more. And basically if we print a disc, it's going to sell just off the shelves. So why don't you come over? Let's put together a cool collab and upcharge them $5 and we'll give you, you know, four of those dollars and we'll just enjoy our really expensive disc. That would make sense to me. I just, it's going to be so weird when it's like, oh yeah, come get a goat Macbeth and Climo buzz. I know, you know, Climo probably has never thrown a buzz in competitive play in his life, but yeah, come get a buzz. Like
it is weird.
It's weird. It also, I also wonder like, what is the breakdown of demo? And I'll have to go look at the fandom survey, when this part of it comes out.
Well, Ken Climo is not listed in the fandom survey.
I'm not.
I haven't played competitive disc golf in 20 years.
Correct, but I'm wondering, like, age demographic, right? What percentage of disc golfers in our sport these days are too young to have ever watched a Ken Climo round, right? I never watched Ken Climo play professionally. I never watched one of Ken Climo's championships. So
I got the chart.
Okay, great.
And we'll put it up on the YouTube version for folks. So. If you're looking at, so like what age do you feel like someone needs to be to have watched Climo play?
I think your gray area
is, like, it's kind of hard because it's like, when did you first start playing?
Sure.
Is really the more relevant.
It's true.
Topic. But if you're just looking at age breakdown, like by far the largest group of the sport is millennials. They're at the top of the curve. And then you have like a little bit more on the Gen X side. So birth years out to about 1965, then on Gen Z, and then the boomers are a small chunk, you know, starting 1964 all the way out to like born in the late, you know, early 1940s.
Yeah.
So, it, you know, it's, but, right, how many of those people started competing or knowing about disc golf within the last 5 years, 10 years? Right. 15 years, right? Even if you're if you started paying attention 15 years ago, Climo was still a topic, but he was not really playing much at that point.
So,
but it's not like people don't know who he is.
No, they do. But so Climo won Worlds last in 2006. I am almost 28. I would have been 9 when Climo won his world last last world championships. Like,
here's what I'll say about it. If I was a Ken Climo fan, I would probably be looking for like classic Climo Innova stuff and not really getting that excited about Climo.
Look for the collector stuff to sell?
Not even necessarily to sell, just because like...
This is to go on sale.
This is what the dude, like, this is who he is. This is his legacy.
Yes. Yeah.
And like, I'm not going to blame the guy at all. By the way, we reached out to Ken. He neither confirmed nor denied the Discraft folks reporting that. So, you know, we'll find out probably sometime after the first of the year some of the details, maybe most of the details. But I don't blame him at all for taking the money.
No.
Like, if he's getting a better deal, go take the money. And he started a Twitter account now. He's, like, trying to fight back against the fake Twitter account. Yeah. Like, this is like super internet drama that we don't even need to get into here. But, you know, it looks like he's going to start getting more active on social media. We may see him have a more presence in the sport. Obviously, people have liked his commentary. Maybe we'll see him do more of that now. That would be an obvious way to like, but it still just feels like a weird way to try to like market him in year 2024, 2025. Mm-hmm. But I don't know. I guess maybe there's ROI.
Can't know till you start selling the discs, right?
Like, I think people will buy a Macbeth Climo collab disc, right?
Let me ask you this,
people will buy that.
So you put a Macbeth Climo collab disc, or you put like a Macbeth legacy disc or something, right? And you put all of Macbeth's wins or something, and you make it all of his wins through 2025, and you say, because when did he win his first Worlds? Was it 2015 or 2014? It was 14, huh?
Yeah, I think so.
Sell a decade of excellence disc from 2014 to 2024. Are you telling me that the Climo disc is going to sell $200,000 more worth of discs than any special Macbeth disc that you run? I don't know if I buy it.
I hear you. I hear you.
I am more apt to go buy a Macbeth Legacy Luna to hang on my wall than I am to go buy a Ken Climo Macbeth collab.
Let it be noted that in October, mid-October, climodiscs.com was registered. All privacied up, so you don't know who registered it. But
if we have a listener who's like some sort of a hacker and is able to get access to that, give us a call.
it is, again, if you think about the symbolism,
sure.
Discraft and Innova have been the big dogs going way back. And Discraft for a long time was second fiddle. And they have made up a lot of ground in the last few years. And Innova has seen its market share slip quite a bit as the sport has grown. And now this. I mean, it's got to be it's a huge slap in the face to Innova.
Yeah.
And it's got to be very frustrating for them because they, I imagine, feel like these players that they have feel that they have supported and been loyal to are like going out and taking these deals, and it's so unfair. You know what though? You got to pay people then.
Yeah.
Like if you're not willing to meet them and recognize the value and pay up for that, then this is what's going to happen. And this is capitalism. you know, it doesn't mean Innova's going away, but it certainly signals that Discraft is on top right now. And they might be, from a market share perspective. It is possible.
Well, the other part is too, like, why was Innova not releasing the occasional Climo disc? And not just, I mean, like, his name at the little bottom of it. Why weren't they doing Legacy Rocks that were Ken Climo? And like,
do you think that gets people hyped up?
Like, I don't know.
You're just telling me that you don't think it does. So
I think it's better than Climo selling discs that he's never thrown. Like,
you gotta get this buzz. I mean, this is the one.
don't worry, guys. I may never have thrown it, but it sure does feel good in the hand.
Oh man, it feels great in the hand. Yeah, I don't know.
It's different to me. It's different. Yeah.
Interesting. More to come as we learn more. Disc Golf Pro Tour Player of the Year Awards came out over the weekend. Gannon Burr takes it in MPO. Certainly no surprise there.
It would have been criminal. I would imagine
it was probably unanimous. Like, everyone. If you voted and you didn't pick Gannon, I mean, you're probably right because there's fan vote, right? One third media vote, one third player vote, like tour card holder vote, one third points. Maybe somebody on the tour or media picked not Gannon, but it would be like you should lose your vote.
After the Pro Tour Championships, I just think there is zero shot that Ricky picked Gannon for Pro Tour Championship.
No, I think even Ricky would admit that
I'd
Gannon
be interested.
Had the best season.
He's, DGPT, he's let us know. I'd be shocked if they didn't announce that it was unanimous.
If it had been?
Yeah.
It's pure salt if you didn't vote for Gannon. Anyway,
yeah.
Easy call, no surprise. On the FPO side, I would definitely classify it as a surprise. Missy Gannon wins her second Player of the Year award. And the interesting note here is that Kristen came out on top in the media vote and the player vote, but was, of course, third in the Pro Tour standings. And so Missy Gannon finished second in the media vote and in the player vote and was first in points. So when you average that out, it was a tie. What's a tiebreaker? Points. So Missy Gannon wins on the tiebreaker basically because she beat Kristen at MVP Open and basically because she out-Kristened Kristen with the forehand approach shot onto the 18th green, which is wild to think about. Like, that shot won her the point standings, the tournament, and ultimately player of the year when it was all said and done. Congratulations to Missy. I think this award is certainly much more deserved than when she won last time because people were tired of voting for Paige.
That
was bad. But I will say, like, we both had Kristen at the top of our ballot, and I think when you sit down and you look at the stats and, like, the top, you know, podium percentage and win rate and all of those things, like, clearly Kristen was still the better player. Missy played a lot more, and Missy did have a lot of wins, match Kristen on wins, so it's not like it's completely outrageous, but I didn't even have Missy second on my ballot. I had Evelina.
I did too. So here's my issue with this system and the way this went down, okay? 30 points separates Missy from Kristen. 30 points, for reference, is the equivalent of 17th-ish, 19th, top 20. Let's see, is that a pro plus? No. If you finish top 20 at a DGPT event, you get 20 points or 30 points.
It's basically tied.
It's basically tied. The issue I have is that and I don't know how they do it, so correct me if you know, but if they just said second, first, and average those three positions, the issue is that it doesn't take into account, like, what were the voting splits between first and second? If Kristen got 70% of the first place votes, it has the points. It has the 5-4-3-2-1, right? So, like, if Kristen has double Missy's points in both voting categories.
Yeah, it shouldn't just be a rank vote.
It shouldn't be a rank vote. It shouldn't just be based on the position of finish. So I'm curious to know how they use the points and combine, because those 30 points is basically tied, which means the vote, like, should be the ones that decide it.
Let's imagine a scenario where everyone votes for, let's just argue in this case, Kristen, right?
Okay,
everyone votes for Kristen first. 100%
vote one, yeah.
But the players and the fans, and the media. I'm sure that didn't happen, but let's just, for the argument, let's say that did happen.
Yep.
Everybody voted Kristen first, Missy second, and whoever else.
Yep.
Like, how are you, if everybody votes for Kristen first, that's the same as 51% of people voting Kristen first and 49% of people voting Missy first and Kristen wins. But, like, you're not accounting at all for the fact that there's, like, this massive gulf.
Well, that could be. I would be interested to know if that's how it's done.
Well, right. They don't really specify how they do the...
Because what if they just combine Pro Tour points with your points from voting, right? Because you get 5 points for a first place vote. So maybe Missy's voting wasn't that far behind Kristen, in which case I still think you're wrong.
My understanding is that it's like rank.
It's basically rank. That's a dumb system. It does not account for performance inside of a category, which can be not reflective.
I get wanting to have Pro Tour points be like a chunk of this.
Sure.
Because you're rewarding not only performance, but also like volume of performance, right?
Right.
Missy played a lot more events than Kristen. And you can definitely make a case that should count for something, right? The PDGA Player of the Year award, playing a lot is a big part of winning that award.
Sure.
So I just feel like the tiebreaker should probably be the vote rather than the points. I don't know. Like, I don't think this is like a fraudulent outcome, but it doesn't feel like the fact that the media and the players said that Kristen was still the best player this year and then she doesn't win feels weird.
Let me also offer a solution. What you need to do is you need to take the top points, because it uses a point system for the voting, right? So let's say Kristen, I don't know how many people vote. Let's say Kristen earned 735 points in her voting, right?
Sure. And whatever.
Then what you do, set that as 100% and then give people points relative to the top mark.
Yeah, yeah.
So
you normalize each category's points. Yeah.
To a 100-point scale,
and then you sum their points, and then in an equal fashion, it still gives you a 33% weighting.
Yeah,
but it does let
shows the differences.
Relative.
Yes,
we're on the same page.
Absolutely. And if you want to either do it by gross points in Disc Golf Pro Tour, or even if you wanted to like normalize it in a way that mirrors a disc golf tournament. So Missy gets 200 or 100 points because she won, and then Kristen gets like 80 or whatever the second place is, and you normalize that as well according to their tournament scale, then great, do that. I don't care how you normalize it, but these three should be normalized to account for relative performance inside of a category that is then contributing to the overall decision. And I don't think that happened.
Yeah. Interesting.
That's fine. We'll give people the real awards.
There was also the community award or something like that. Went to Paul McBeth and Kristen Tatar. That was completely a community champion, they called it. Voted for exclusively by tour card holders. So congrats to McBeth and Tatar for that. It's time to get into the Upshot Awards for 2024. This is always a lot of fun. And make sure you get yourself a subscription. Jump in the Discord because we'll be doing the Sheddies right after this live in the Discord inside the circle. And the Sheddies is for the ignominious, the worst of the year. So we will have a lot of fun with that as well. Josh, let's get right to it. I think we already know what we're going to say here, but player of the year from the Upshot Awards this year, who do the awards go to in 2024?
Charlie, it was unanimous. Gannon Burr and Kristen Tatar win player of the Upshot Player of the Year award. Congratulations in unanimous decision.
We have not been always unanimous on this. I mean, you remember last year, it was like a real, we had a long series of debates about MPO Player of the Year. Ultimately, Josh, I convinced you to vote for Calvin. But this year, it was close in FPO. I mean, it wasn't like I had to sit down and really look at it, right?
Agreed. You
know, Evelina has the two major wins. She got the Worlds. Her best season ever.
Yep.
Kristen was good, but, you know, not as good. I think the thing that it came down to for me is that once you strip away the expectations for Kristen of, like, total dominance, and then you just look at the raw numbers, Kristen won most categories.
Yes. Yep.
And that made it like, you know, if it's close, you have to just go with the person who's, you know, winning most of the categories. And, you know, I think it would have been more clear if she'd won one more major or even one more tournament. It was close, but at the end of the day, you know, some of the wins for these other players were when Kristen wasn't playing.
Right.
And that you have to account for that.
Yes. Well, the other issue is like Evelina had some glaring holes in her resume in terms of average finish, lowest ranked performance, things like that. Missy didn't have any glaring holes. But the problem was is that Kristen just was better than her in every category by just a little bit, except Pro Tour points, which, again, Kristen took, you know, two months and change off in the season to get married and break her rib. And so despite that,
I'm going to take a little time off. I'm going to break my rib.
Despite that, Kristen still outperformed Missy in basically every statistic. Like Missy was just Kristen light this year. And so for me, while it was close, we had to look at it. I think Kristen Tatar should have been kind of the clear choice for the player of the year on the FPO side.
All right. Let's get to the comeback player of the year. On one of these, we agree with the Pro Tour's choice. In MPO, the Upshot Award goes to Gavin Rathbun. What a comeback.
Yes.
What a comeback for Gavin Rathbun. You know, after he gets the season-ending injury a couple years ago, comes back, just really isn't right, and then gets back out there this year and has a really great season. I mean,
no,
he makes
sponsor.
Yeah. I mean, lots of top tens, third place finish at DDO, second place finish at OTB, fourth place finish at Beaver State, like that great run through the West Coast swing. Still finishing like regularly in the top 20. Kind of cooled off a little bit at the back end of the season, but still top 15 at USDGC. Just like all around a really solid season for Gavin, a total bounce back from like a pretty disappointing 2023 campaign. Mm-hmm. You know, more than doubled his prize earnings this year compared to last. And it feels like we might see Gavin get back up to being like seriously competitive and maybe win a tournament. I mean, he wasn't that far away this year.
Well, he wasn't. I really think he could do that. So good. Congratulations to Gavin.
On the FPO side, there really only felt like there was one player who really came back, and that was Paige Pierce, who, of course, slipped on the bridge last year, had to miss the whole second half of the season with the injury, and then comes back. And while she is not the player that she once was, she still won a tournament in 2024 and, you know, had some really great moments. Like she was not consistent the way that she has been in the past, but she still cashed at most tournaments she played, multiple top fives, a good player. I think if we see her regain some of the precision with her upshots, we could see her back at the top of the leaderboard on a regular basis.
It's When I picked this award initially, you know, I didn't pick Paige because I don't want this to have to necessarily be an injury comeback player of the year. I think that kind of makes our choice for us in a lot of years. Fortunately, I don't think disc golf has a high number of very serious injuries the players are bouncing back from. The fact that Paige gets a win is just such a big deal. And so absolutely makes sense why she does get this award.
Yeah, it's great to see her back and playing, and seemingly enjoying playing, and I wouldn't be surprised if we see her improve next year.
Yeah.
Josh, who won the Rising Star Award this year?
It feels convenient that you waited to have me announce this award, Charlie. Rising Star. I want to give our nominees a shout-out. Evan Smith was nominated here. Joey Buckets was nominated here. But our final decision for the Rising Star Award goes to Ezra Robinson, whose performance at the Disc Golf Pro Tour just highlighted what was, I mean, from the beginning to the end of the season, just being in contention all the time on all sorts of courses, and has really just risen in the 1040 club to a level that it's getting to the point that we are probably going to start talking about the fact that it's a little bit glaring that Ezra Robinson has not won a tournament yet, because that's how good he is playing. So Ezra Robinson gets our Rising Star of the Year award on the MPO side.
Yeah, I mean, if he wins one, I feel like it's like people are going to be really talking about him.
Yes.
I still get the sense that like the casual fan maybe doesn't know Ezra Robinson that much.
You got to win, man.
You got to win.
Got to win.
You got to win. On the FPO side?
FPO side goes to Emily Weatherman. Gets a win also. Well deserved. Yeah. I think anyone who knew our voting and kind of listened this season knew that Emily Weatherman was probably going to win this award from us. It is worth noting we did consider Silva, but Silva won it last year and didn't quite feel like the right fit for the award this year. So Emily Weatherman,
I think if you win it, you don't win it again.
You don't win it again. Exactly. Exactly. You can't be a rising star multiple years in a row.
And Silva was rising last year and almost feels established now. I mean,
yes. Yeah. That's how I feel.
Yeah.
Too.
I mean, Emily wins the DGPT Rookie of the Year. I mean, what a start. Like, to win a tournament at that age, basically in your first year on tour, is kind of crazy.
Yeah, it is.
Awesome performance. We now go to the Owen Scoggins Dog of the Year Award. Owen Scoggins is not eligible to win this award because she would always win it. So we've named it after her instead. By the way, forthcoming fandom survey result, Owen Scoggins, the most popular player among women respondents to the survey. I get it.
I guess. She's incredible.
The Owen Scoggins Dog of the Year in MPO is James Proctor. There's a lot of reasons that, you know, Proctor wins Dog of the Year. You know, he plays through getting married this year, comes back out after the wedding. He's balling. He goes out and he jams a crazy putt to win MVP Open. He comes on this podcast and says he's the best putter on earth. he's just got that dog in him. I don't know. Like, what an awesome year. And he's like, next year might be my last year. I'm about to just walk away. That also makes you a dog.
James Proctor is definitely the dog. Congratulations. You know, of all the awards, this is the one that I really want to send to people. Just have them, like, an award show up at their house that says Owen Scoggins Dog of the Year with no explanation. Like, get it to him 2 weeks before we actually make the announcement or something. I think that'd be hilarious. Congratulations to James. Who's our FPO dog, Charlie?
FPO Dog of the Year goes to Evelina Salonen. What a gritty performance that she put in this year. She was never really like locked in on the putting green, but she has overcome so much to get back to the point where she's making the comebackers pretty much every time. And she's hitting those edge of circle putts more than she used to, certainly. And her improved putting was a direct, you know, like that directly led to her winning more this year. She wins the world championships despite not putting well at all, like had to grit through it and wins this, you know, the biggest tournament of her career. Just generally has the best season of her career. And despite the ups and downs, you know, she's not the like locked in consistent player like Kristen. She manages her emotions really well and she always stays positive. It's dog stuff.
I also want to give credit. She won a tournament in a playoff by hitting a circle two putt.
Yeah.
After making a circle two putt on an elevated basket to force the playoff at Copenhagen. And so, you know, I think the knock against Evelina's resume here are the couple of chokes that she kind of gave away. But the fact that she's able to turn that around and still continue to win, not let that define her season, and be in the Player of the Year contest, I mean, we would not have said that at the beginning of the season. So congratulations to Evelina there.
It's time for the Upshot Award for Performance of the Year, Josh.
An MPO. It's got to go to Gannon Burr at European Open, who, thanks to, and the final round was like, he let Ricky back in, but his performance over the course of those four rounds was dominant. It was the look of somebody who was in complete control and a real champion who then executes on the backhand shot on hole 18, which is riskier than the forehand, which most people play, but does it in order to set himself up in position, and Ricky is not able to execute the upshot. It's an incredible performance from Gannon Burr, and gets the performance of the year nod here for the Upshot Awards.
Well, just crazy high rating that weekend as mm-hmm. well. Had to play through literally insane pressure from Ricky. Ricky shot an unbelievable final round, and Gannon withstood it. And the heckler. Remember the heckler?
Yeah, and the heckler. I remember the heckler. Yeah, yep. Yeah, I wonder if he'll be back
you
next year
suck.
For Worlds.
And in FPO, Josh, who wins it?
This one goes to Missy Gannon, MVP.
How not only it was not?
It, how could it not? Not only was it just like an incredible performance throughout the week, she hits the putt on the death putt on 17 in order to tie the round. She goes to 18, beats Kristen at her own game with the forehand approach on 18, and then, because of the win at MVP, wins Player of the Year. How could that not be the performance of the year? Missy Gannon gets the win here, and I don't even think it was close. I think that's the one we picked first, and it was just instantaneous.
Second highest event rating of the season, behind 10-13, behind Owen Scoggins at Texas States, which we considered for this
we
award.
We did.
Owen did have that unbelievable round, but it just, the course,
the significance.
Yeah, or this was Open at Austin, yeah. Right? That
Open at Austin, Texas yeah, States, yeah.
Long Texas tournament. Too many. I can't keep track. She didn't really have the pressure on her. MVP, just like, you're on the best course in the United States. You're going head to head with world number one, and to win it in the fashion that she did, with really intense pressure, and to rate that high on a mostly wooded course, it was an incredible show for Missy Gannon. Yeah. And she won everything else because of it. Tournament points. Pro Tour, everything. Crazy.
Got it all. Yep.
The marketing moment of the year goes to Kristen reaching 1,000 rated. Not 1,001. Not 1,001. 1,000. It's a milestone in many ways. We could have made any number of categories to recognize this achievement. But... you know, for a long time we talked about when will an FPO player reach 1,000 rated? Will Paige get there? Paige had that shot during COVID, couldn't quite get the job done. Had to play really well through a stretch of Texas, didn't happen. And then it felt like, okay, this is not going to happen for a while. For it to happen, basically 2 years later, the meteoric rise from Kristen, incredible moment. They're obviously going to sell a zillion discs because of it. And, for all that Kristen has done, this may be the thing that people remember the most.
Mm-hmm.
Not the major sweep, yep. Getting to 1,000 rated first.
Yeah, I think so, too. We considered the wind dragon, but 1,000 rated Kristen did win out here. Business story of the year is one that we chose not to pick anything specific here. Last year, we talked about the House of Disc Acquisitions. This year, though, it goes to the Disc Golf Slowdown. It is a one that kind of systemic throughout the entire industry. It's touched all elements from broadcasting to the Pro Tour to disc sales and merch and player signings. Like, the entire disc golf landscape is shifting due to the bottom of the money kind of falling out a little bit. And that is kind of defined this season, is going to define this off season as well. And it's going to be interesting to watch how that continues as we move forward. But it though not terribly specific, it's one that has has to have the probably biggest ramifications of a business story that we've seen in several years.
I mean, this is a this is the flip side of what happened during COVID, and people are reconfiguring how they're operating, and we're seeing, you know, belts tightening and layoffs, and you know, I don't think this is like a long term downtrend, but I think it could sustain for another year or two. And it's affecting everything about how disc golf is operating right now. Media personality of the year. Congratulations to Esa-Pekka Tuupela, who, of course, was the DGN commentator that anchored the coverage over in Europe this year. And Esa-Pekka was one of the most popular commentators this season. Kind of just brings a gravitas to the booth. Really makes you feel like you're watching European disc golf too, because of the accent. And you know, I think we're going to see a lot more of Esa-Pekka in the future. And congratulations to him for winning Media Personality of the Year.
No argument for me. Put Esa-Pekka on for every European tournament. I'm good with that.
Josh, next up, we've got the biggest off-season signing. This is from last off-season, and I don't know if our answer would have been the same at the beginning of the year as it is at the end. I think there's two clear candidates: Eagle to MVP and Gannon to Discmania. Okay. Who does the award go to?
Award's got to go to Gannon at Discmania. I am not 100% even convinced that Gannon outsold discs compared to Eagle, but when you're able to go pick up the next goat of disc golf and have him just put a beat down on the field like he did this season, tell me how that you're not, if you're not Discmania, you're not just jumping over the moon with this signing.
Are you locking him in as next goat?
I mean, are you not?
I don't know.
It's not for sure that he will obtain that status, but there's nobody else in the field who deserves that title.
No, for sure.
Next potential GOAT, right?
For sure.
He's the only one.
For sure.
So
you could still see AB getting there, I think.
You could see AB.
But he would have to turn up a lot.
He would. He would.
All right. We've got more to come on the other side. The best hole of the year, the best tournament of the year, putt, upshot, drive. It's all next right here on The Upshot. The Upshot is presented by Pound Disc Golf, makers of the best bags in the sport. If you're looking for the perfect holiday gift for somebody that you love, or hey, maybe yourself, you deserve it too. Go to PoundDiscGolf.com and make the custom pack of your dreams. You can do the custom pack builder for all of their packs, whether it's an Octothorpe, a Rufus, a Vagabond. You can design it exactly how you want. The outside fabric, the zippers, the attachments, the patches, every little bit of the bag fully available to be customized by you. And you can do it all at PoundDiscGolf.com. Hey, just go check it out. Build a pack of your dreams and maybe you put it in your cart and think about it for a couple days. Well, temperatures are dropping, days are shorter, but our day-to-day stresses remain the same. As we wind down 2024, you deserve to rest and recharge. Thankfully, one of our sponsors can help with that. The folks over at Sunset Lake have kicked off their Black Friday sale. Right now, you can save 30% site-wide when you head to sunsetlakecbd.com and use the code FRIDAY. They've got everything you need to chill out and enjoy your time this holiday season, from tinctures to gummies to topicals and even products for your pets. Sunset Lake is even throwing in some freebies this year. If your order is over $100, they'll give you a free 20-count jar of Relax Functional Mushroom Gummies. And if it's over $200, you'll get a 20-count jar of the same. I tell you what, they've got the new non-melatonin sleep gummies that have just a little bit of THC in them. Really, really nice. Super nice way to relax at the end of the day and get some great sleep. So head over to sunsetlakecbd.com and use the code FRIDAY to save 30%. See their site for terms and conditions. Welcome back to The Upshot. We've got some more awards to give away here for 2024 and our Upshot Awards. Josh, I want to take us to the course. And so why don't we do the number one hole of the year?
I always love thinking about, like, trying to think about new holes and other considerations. A new hole is actually going to make a feature a little bit later on this award that I want to talk about. But when you think about the impact that the hole had, the drama, the excitement, the crowd, the energy, all the above, I think that there, and this is in both divisions, I think there is only one choice here. And that has to be hole 18 at MVP. I could probably think of a couple other holes on each side, but the fact that they happened together at the same tournament, I think just elevates their status. And it really was perhaps the most singular impactful hole across the divisions in the entire year. We've talked about Missy, James Proctor in the putt. What an incredible moment, and clearly just has to be the hole of the year.
No arguments from me. The drama was unbelievable on that hole this year. And it's already a great hole.
Yeah.
Right? Like a baseline, it's a great hole. And it got elevated because of it coming down to the wire in both sides. At, you know, a huge, arguably the biggest non-major of the year.
Mm-hmm.
Right? I mean, that the Pro Tour sets it up that way. It's the last stop in the playoffs, last chance to make the Pro Tour Championship, four rounds of the same course. Pomp and circumstance. And a pond jump. All right, what's next, Josh?
Let's move over to our putt of the year here.
Putt of the year. Okay. Well, yeah. Let me stay where we are.
Okay.
Which is at MVP on hole 18. And James Proctor's putt from the drop zone to win the tournament. And what a sick moment. Like, mm-hmm. the confidence to step up and hit that. So many people would have not given it a chance. They would have been afraid of making a mistake, going out of bounds, ending up losing the tournament because of it. Instead, he jams the putt. You know, he doesn't get Corey Ellis'd by the whole thing, right? Yeah. And, you know, glancing down at his wrist, knowing that he's just got to put it in there. It was just an awesome moment. It was easily the putt of the year.
Yeah. Let me ask you this. Is FPO hole 17 at MVP?
That was sick. Missy's huge jam. That's a candidate, but I don't think it wins.
Okay.
But it was huge.
I thought MVP might have, like, was going to sweep these awards here. It was close.
It was close, but it's going to go to Holland Handley hitting the huge circle two putt on the elevated basket on hole 18 at the Beaver State Fling to force a playoff. She would go on to win. It was her first Elite Series win. Remember, she won Throw Pink. You know, all the caveats with that. But her first Pro Tour win. Why don't we say that? And, you know, just an absolutely sick, like, must make, and buried it. There were a number of good candidates, but Holland, because you already mentioned Evelina hitting the circle two putt to win in Europe.
In Copenhagen.
It just, the degree of difficulty plus how critical it was, plus the fact that it, like, directly led to the win, right? Missy still had to win it on 18 at MVP.
That is true. That is true.
But great I wouldn't blame you if you felt like Missy should have won.
It was...
We're getting MVP voter fatigue over here.
That's right. That's right.
Okay, how about upshot of the year, Josh?
Okay. MPO, this is one that I think separates a little bit. We're going to go down the rabbit hole a little bit for a while. Joey Buckets, Idlewild, throws that crazy upshot and chains out and is able to take down the win. What, like, it's his first win. He's able to close it out after being in contention so many times and then kind of faltering in the final round, and to do it in such a signature fashion, top tier upshot here.
It was so wild. A little inside behind the curtain view here.
Okay. Because you commentated this tournament.
I commentated this tournament. So he's on the left side of the fairway. It's that long tunnel fairway, and then it opens up and there's a couple of guardian trees, and then the basket is behind them.
Yep.
So a lot of players are just trying to like slide something up to land in front of the trees and skip or slide up to the basket. Mm-hmm. And you know, he all he had to do was get up and down. You know, he didn't need to do anything fancy. And he was in a pretty good spot. Like, he wasn't in the middle of the fairway. He was on the left side, mm-hmm. kind of in the woods, had a little bit of a tight angle, but mostly should be able to get up and down, no problem. And so we had thrown it down to Nate Perkins to get a read on where, you know, where his lie was and how, like, what was his approach shot looking like. And Mahmood, the producer, said, hey, let's let Nate call the shot here. So we're sitting there and Nate is talking and he's set line, you know, he's talking about him lining it up, and shot goes up and it hits chains, you know, and almost sticks. And I completely forget that it's supposed to be Nate calling the shot. So like, I'm screaming, Nate is screaming, we're going crazy. Like, if you go back and listen to the coverage, and then of course I was very apologetic afterwards. I told Nate, I'm so sorry that I like blew up the spot there. But it was just like such a big moment that it was like hard not to have a big reaction there. But yeah, what a way to walk it off.
Yeah, absolutely. Upshot of the year goes to the forehand aficionado herself, Missy Gannett MVP hole 18.
Gotta.
We've talked enough, you know, about this throw here, but Missy definitely deserves this award without a doubt.
Where do you want to go next, Josh?
Well, we do have a drive of the year candidate here, so let's round out our shots.
This was by far the hardest category this year.
So difficult
for us to pick awards for. There was like lots of good shots. You could pick any number of aces or big drives, long drives, mm-hmm. but there wasn't like iconic drive. Like Ellie Mittling hole 18 throw pink 2023. Right? You're like, okay.
Yeah. Yeah.
That was the best drive we saw all season. No question.
No question.
There was not that this year, but we decided to give Anthony Barella a nod for his shot on Jonesboro hole 18 that locked up the tournament. After other players were kind of scrambling around, and you know, you could pick one of 25 AB drives from this year, mm-hmm. and you wouldn't be wrong. But that's the one that we chose.
It's the fact that he has to throw a hyzer onto an island with two other players right there tied with him, and you know, Calvin comes up next and goes OB because of it, and he gets the win. And it was close, it was stressful, it was pressure filled. And after what had happened at European Open, for Anthony Barella to be able to get a win, like it really just felt like kind of overcoming that moment. I do have a candidate here for FPO as well. It was not in competition though. I'm going to give it Eliezer Middling distance competition at the DGPT All-Stars event. How old's Ellie? Is she like 17, 18?
Yeah, something like that. I think she's
and outdrove
17.
The entire field.
Yeah.
North of 500 feet. Like, it's probably not the official. It probably shouldn't be the official one, but man, I still was just so impressed by that.
Yeah, I'm trying to think if there was like a clear option. I mean, you could pick a number of Evelina drives.
Yeah.
She had some absolute beauties at Worlds this year. But again, nothing that was like really iconic.
Yeah.
So I'm good with that. Ellie Middling is probably going to win a lot of these awards over the years. round of the year, Josh.
On MPO.
Get FPO out of the way.
Okay, I'll get FPO out of the way. Guess what, Charlie? It goes to MVP Open. we're kind of loading on the accolades here for MVP, and I'll be honest,
final round, to be clear.
Final round, yes. I was a little like, oh man, maybe we should start picking other things. You know what? Sometimes a performance is just that good that it sweeps all the Oscars, and yep. MVP is sweeping the Oscars this year, and that's okay.
That's okay.
On MPO though, we chose to give it to round two of the DGPT championships. This might be
shocking non-final round selection.
I was about to say, this might be the only non-final round you will see in this awards history, but the level of play of those two, of Ricky and Gannon, at the DGPT championships in that round, bogey-free, double digits under par for both of them, spectacular electric performance to set up for just a crazy tournament.
Absolutely crazy. Tournament of the year. Let's start on the FPO side. Yep. Let's move on.
Congratulations.
Congratulations to the MVP Open. On the MPO side, it's the European Open that wins the award. It's in World's Preview mode. We get the two best players of the season in an unbelievable duel, playing some of the best disc golf you're going to see. Ricky was in an incredible stretch of play at this time, and still Gannon found a way to beat him. You know, it wasn't quite Eagle versus Paul.
If we did that tournament like of the decade, Eagle Paul's going to win that. Yeah,
that was unreal. Yeah. That was four rounds of like electric disc golf where they just completely obliterated everybody else.
Incredible.
But it was still an amazing tournament this year.
Also came with the drama, hole 17, hitting the fence, the light pole, and then rolling OB on the chain out, or the cage hit. So we got the drama.
We went to 18, and it was not decided.
It was not.
And then Gannon threw a perfect drive, and Ricky was out of position down the hill, and had to try to make something happen, and overcooked it a little bit, and OB, and that was it. But a tremendous tournament, and the addition of the new course, I thought, really was nice. Somebody was saying, this is a slight aside, that like it's unfair that we say that European courses are better than U.S. courses because we only play the top seven courses in all of Europe, and like I see that point,
sure,
but like, why don't we play the seven best courses in the United States? Like, I guess if you take the top seven courses on tour in the U.S. and you make a comparison of those two, I still think I'd pick Europe.
I don't know. It's definitely close there. But here's the other thing. Except Copenhagen. I was not a huge fan of the Copenhagen course. Take Copenhagen out.
Estonian?
Oh, yeah, Estonian Disc Golf Festival.
We will be back with the Estonian Disc Golf Festival in the Sheddies.
Yeah. but like, think about the depth of courses that we didn't even touch in Europe that we absolutely could have hit, right? You've got Kona Piste at the Franz Ferdinand Castle. Incredible property. Jarva, you've got...
We didn't play PCS this year, right?
We didn't play PCS. Like, we could come... Like, there are lots of courses that all... You could swap the seven European courses we played for seven different European courses, and the problem is, and like those would still be equally high quality, and so it, like, because of that, I think that's where Europe gets kind of the nod, and you're right that the top like seven American courses are excellent, they're very, very good, but there is something about the picturesque nature of these European courses, the fans. It's really been a spectacular experience, and I think it was just a huge win by the Pro Tour. You know, maybe that deserves business story of the year, is moving to Europe for the Disc Golf Pro Tour.
I mean, and the takeover of like the streaming side of things. I mean, I guess maybe that happened last year.
Kind of hard to delineate, but definitely deserves a nomination because the tour is better for it.
The tour is better for it. I think it's a long run. Good place to be, too.
Yeah.
All right. That is going to do it for this edition of The Upshot. Join us in our Inside the Circle segment for UltiWorld Disc Golf subscribers for the Sheddies, the worst of the year. Become a UltiWorld Disc Golf subscriber at discgolf.ultiworld.com/subscribe. For Josh Mansfield, I'm Charlie Eisenhood saying so long, and we'll talk to you on Thursday, where we'll be joined by Jamie Thomas for a review of our fantasy season. See you then.